So there are three different cases there, actually. There's building a team from scratch. There's remotivating a team where it's recognized that the team needs something new. And then there's the third one, which is the tricky one, which is trying to motivate a team where they don't realize that they have fallen behind. Building something from scratch, of course, is always exciting. You know, either it's something that you've invented yourself, in which case you have a dream, but you probably haven't turned it into a plan. More often, it's someone else's dream, and you've been appointed to implement it. But there's not, in fact, that much difference. Usually, they have a dream, but they haven't worked out how to deliver on that. So starting something new, starting something from scratch, is exciting, because there will only ever be one first director, right? Your place in history, if you get it right, is assured. All the people who follow will, in some sense, inherit what you have created. The job there is to convince people to take the risk, because doing anything new is a risky thing. It might not work. It may work, but not as well as you'd hoped. And so one of the things you have to do is, when you're recruiting people, is you have to explain to them the vision, and you have to convince them that if they participate, if they share that vision, then together we can achieve something great. And so it's not easy, but it's fun. And if it comes off, you have a great sense of achievement. Being put in to fix a problem, where it's recognized either by the people themselves or by the people who employ them, or where the previous director or whatever has left in something of a cloud, is not so different, in fact, because the people have already recognized the need for change. So what they need is a new vision. They need confidence that you're going to come in there and help them achieve what they want to achieve. So it's not easy. Again, it's not easy, but it's easier. The really tricky one is where you're put in charge of something and they don't realize that they've fallen behind. Because your first job is to convince them that they're not where they ought to be. And that requires enormous diplomatic skills. You first of all have to analyze what's wrong, and then you have to find a way of explaining to them, or better, you have to find a way of getting them to realize for themselves that things have to change. Now, change is always unsettling. There's always risk in change. One of the other key attributes of a scientific leader is the ability to identify risk, manage risk, accept risk, to have a good risk appetite. And when you're taking over a failing organization, particularly if they don't realize they're failing, is that they are at risk. If they don't improve, then they will be out of a job, to put it crudely. Now, but if you put it crudely like that, then you will not take them with you. So they have to discover for themselves. And then you need to work on a plan. And in all three cases, you need the standard essences of any plan. You need a vision, you need a mission, and you need an implementation. And that's a test of your skill, not so much of a manager, but as a leader.